Reese, thank you. Well, welcome to Williams-Brice. Yes, Coach Holtz is quite clear on where he stands in this ball game. As we count down the kickoff, guys, break it down for me. Both quarterbacks would like a little bit of help from the running game, but maybe they can't count on it. And Eric Ainge, who started horribly at home against Alabama last week, you say he better not do that again tonight.
Oh, absolutely. I think the key to the game is Tennessee. Come out smoking, jump ahead of South Carolina, and keep this crowd a little bit quiet.
Obviously, the crowd has to stay in this game if we're going to see an upset tonight. I think the big thing we talked all day about this is that Savelle Newton can really create and make things happen. Tennessee has great athletic ability on that side of the ball. Can Savelle Newton, number one, throw the football? Does he have time to throw to Sidney Rice and Kenny McKinley? And when things break down, can he create and keep the sticks moving? And the other thing is, they have to maximize the opportunities. When the few times they get to the red zone, they've got to score touchdowns.
Maybe they can use Newton's mobility in the red zone. Sidney Rice has been well guarded by SEC teams. He only has the one touchdown. Prediction time, I think.
Well, in the theme of the upsets that we've seen throughout this afternoon, I really think, Lee, that going on the road in the SEC on a Saturday night, you've got to be a lot better than the team you're playing. And that's why I think Savelle Newton's the difference, and I think the defense keeps him in the game. Bulls can't run the ball enough. South Carolina with number 13 beats Tennessee.
You know, I'm going to need some help. Hey, Cousin Smokey, yo, Cousin Smokey, how do you like Tennessee tonight? They looking good? Yeah. Oh, Cousin Smokey looks good. Give me that thing right there. I'm going with Rocky Top. Rocky Top wins tonight.
Hey, by the way, the real Smokey, he bit an Alabama player.
That's all right. He's ready to go.
Yeah, last week.
Thank you, Rocky.
Something to keep an eye on.
Thank you, Smokey.
So we got a split decision
Rocky
down here.
Top.
Yes.
Rocky Top.
A decision this quarter of the stadium, which is the big orange quarter. But the Gamecocks about to make their entrance, and we'll see if they can pull the upset. It'll be the first win over a top 10 team in about 8 tries. Upstairs now to Mike Patrick.
Is it all? All right, thank you, Chris. We're expecting a record crowd here tonight, and most of them are already up in arms with Lee Corso. This is the biggest game in Columbia, South Carolina in a long, long time, especially after last year's win at Tennessee and Steve Spurrier's history with the Vols and Philip Fulmer. Add to that, it's a must-win situation for both. It's the number 8 Tennessee Volunteers at 6-1 in South Carolina to face the 5-2 Gamecocks. It's a packed house of over 80,000 here at Williams-Brice Stadium for a primetime showdown in the SEC. Good evening, everybody. Mike Patrick, Todd Blackledge. It's great to have you with us. Holly Rowe will join us shortly. With Florida beating Georgia in Jacksonville this afternoon, it means both of these teams are chasing the Gators in the SEC East. Certainly, there's a lot of football to go in this season, but the bottom line is for these two teams, this is a huge ball game.
Yeah, well, Tennessee's lone loss was to Florida, so they've got a win to just kind of keep pace with the Gators, hope they get some help. South Carolina, ironically, even though they have two conference losses, they control their own destiny because they've got Tennessee tonight, Florida in a couple weeks. Bottom line, huge for both.
Both of these coaches are winning again. We've come to expect it from each one of them, but they're certainly doing it uncharacteristically this year.
Yeah, I can't figure it out. Philip Fulmer's the former offensive lineman. They're throwing the ball all over the place. Steve Spurrier, the Heisman Trophy winning quarterback, he's called running plays 55% of the time this year, but they're doing what good coaches do. They're playing to their strengths. For Tennessee, their strength is their quarterback, Eric Ainge, and they're putting the ball in number 10's hands, and he's played beautifully this year under the tutelage of David Cutcliffe, offensive coordinator. He's big, he's got a strong arm, he's worked hard on his mechanics and his fundamentals. His accuracy has gone through the roof from 45% last year to 67%. Now, South Carolina, Savelle Newton is not a typical quarterback Steve Spurrier is used to coaching. He's a dual threat guy. That means he can make it happen with his legs, and he can make it happen when he leaves the pocket and creates when a play is not there. But make no mistake, Savelle Newton can throw the football. He's completing over 60% of his passes as well. Two very productive quarterbacks tonight.
Todd, back in the 80s, Joe Morrison was the head coach here and was looking for a way to fire up the crowd before the team took the field. What he came up with was the theme song from the hit movie 2001, and it has rightfully taken its place among the traditions that make college football so special.
It's time for Carolina football.
College Football Primetime, brought to you by CDW, the right technology, right away, Edward Jones, making sense of investing, and Expedia.com. Enjoy your trip.
ESPN's College Football Primetime is broadcast in high definition, presented by Pioneer Plasma Displays. There is a history, of course, between these two coaches, and Holly Rowe, it always hasn't been a pleasant history either.
Well, that's right, Mike. People may have the impression that these two coaches actually cannot stand each other. It's been a huge rivalry over the years, but I asked both of them yesterday what their relationship is really like. Steve Spurrier said it's good. It's not bad at all. Philip Fulmer actually used the words healthy and respectful. When Steve Spurrier was in Knoxville recruiting this summer, he actually called Philip Fulmer. Philip did likewise when he was here in town speaking at a volunteers luncheon. So both guys really do like each other. That rivalry is not as important as you might think, but guys, neither one of them have played for over 20 years, so I think it's more important, the rivalry between these players.
Well, Holly, I'll tell you what, Steve Spurrier still has the needle. It may not get to Philip Fulmer, but it gets to Tennessee fans.
Well, I think the biggest difference in their relationship is two of the last 4 years they played each other when Steve was at Florida. Tennessee split those games and won two of the four. And I think that changed the dynamic of their relationship and made it more, quote-unquote, respectful.
That's a great point. Captain Munnerlyn and Carlos Thomas are deep to receive the opening kickoff. Thomas, 5 yards deep, he'll keep it there.
Well, South Carolina hopes to get it going offensively tonight, possess the football. Sidney Rice and Kenny McKinley, they're two outstanding receivers. A lot of attention paid to Sidney Rice. His numbers not as high as a year ago, but McKinley has really stepped up. And Corey Boyd, coming off of back-to-back 100-yard games, he gives him that threat in the running game. Very important for South Carolina to have a good run-pass balance. And, of course, Savelle Newton gives him both of that. Excellent thrower, second leading rusher on the football team.
And you might think this would be a dream come true for him, but it actually hurts his pro career. He knows he's not going to make it as a quarterback. He'll make it as a wide receiver or a defensive back if he does. And this is really cutting into his experience in that position. Let's take a look at the starting lineup presented by the U.S. Postal Service. South Carolina's offensive line has been a problem. Some of their weaknesses disguised now by that much more mobile quarterback.
Well, they've played three different guys at left tackle. Jamon Meredith is their best offensive tackle. He's started every game at the right side. They moved him over to the left side the second half of last week in the Vanderbilt game because they were having trouble with Vanderbilt's Curtis Gatewood. So now Meredith starts on the left side, the blind side of the quarterback, Savelle Newton.
Mike West, a former linebacker, is now a wide receiver, is into the ballgame with 4-4 speed. You don't find that in linebackers very often.
Dead ball foul. Delay of game. Offense. 5-yard penalty. Still second down.
Now, this is not the kind of start Steve Spurrier wanted in his first possession. They had 8 penalties last week in the game against Vanderbilt, along with 4 turnovers. They were able to overcome that and beat Vanderbilt. They can't have that kind of a sloppy game against a team the quality of Tennessee. They had no yardage gained on the first play and a penalty on the second play.
Freddie Brown, number 82, comes in as a fourth wide receiver, 3 to the top of the screen. 4-man rush, Newton. Throws underneath and it's intercepted, picked off by the middle linebacker Marvin Mitchell. And Mitchell, touchdown. Yards on the deflection.
Well, Mitchell got the interception and the score, but it was Jonathan Wade who made the play for Tennessee. He's the one that was defending and ripped the ball out and caused Mitchell to get the pick.
Tennessee's defense gets the first points of the ball game. Wilhoit, the veteran place kicker, is on for the point after. And Newton, who had done so well, makes a mistake early, and Tennessee capitalizes. The Volunteers with the early 7-0 lead. Tennessee's defense with a big early play, and they convert on the interception return for a 7-0 lead. And did that quiet 80,000 people?
Well, you mentioned Mike West, who was going to see his first action tonight. Former linebacker has had a hamstring problem almost all the way through the season. Steve Spurrier really hoping he could come along as the number 3 receiver, and not a good way for him to start.
Steve Spurrier just saw tremendous record when scoring first, lousy record when not scoring first. The only exception last week against Vanderbilt. This time they'll start at the 21-yard line.
I want you to watch now. Mike West is going to be right here, and he's going to run a little in route. And the guy to watch is Jonathan Wade. Watch him. It's a zone defense for Tennessee. So he's going to release Sidney Rice down the field and then read this in route. And it's a good throw by Savelle Newton, but Jonathan Wade just ripped the ball out, much as you would do a strip drill to cause a fumble. He ripped the ball out, it stayed up in the air, and Mitchell got the interception.
Handoff, Boyd plows his way across the 25. Gerard Mayo makes the tackle. Take a look at that Tennessee defense. After losing its best player, the defensive line has adapted very well, particularly McBride, who moved from end to tackle.
Yeah, Turk McBride, very versatile, can play both sides, or inside or outside, has really settled in inside. And Xavier Mitchell at left end has really started to come into his own as a pass rusher as well. Had a big sack on Alabama's last possession in the game a week ago.
Boyd gets the carry again, South Carolina. Trying to keep it on the ground, establish something right here. Mayo again on another tackle. He has had a tremendous year. Pretty good set of linebackers for the Volunteers.
Well, South Carolina, one of their goals is to kind of shorten the game. I mean, they know that they can't get in a shootout, in a high-scoring, back-and-forth kind of game with Tennessee or anybody for that matter. They've got to sustain the football. They've got to drive it. And fewer possessions actually works better for South Carolina in the way they're playing football right now.
Newt in the shotgun. There's that option, and they give it to Boyd again. He's up to the 40. A lot of big play potential for Corey Boyd. The last two games, 113 yards apiece.
Take a look at what Tennessee has done the last 7 quarters. At halftime of the Georgia game 2 weeks ago, John Chavis lit into his defense. They had given up 24 points in the first half. He got after him, and ever since then, ever since the third quarter of the Georgia game, they have played outstanding football.
Corey Boyd again. They're exploiting the middle of that line, and Boyd out near the 49-yard line, and that offensive line has opened up some running lanes.
Well, we mentioned the new left tackle, the new right tackle, Sorensen. Nice blocking at the point of attack. Nice block by the tight end in there, Robert Pavlovic, number 93. So we have a new left tackle and a new right tackle as far as starters go for South Carolina. Right now, opening some lanes in the running game.
Sorensen's interesting. He's out of Vancouver, British Columbia, and by his own admission, does not have good feet. Yeah. He says his technique has to be about perfect for everything to work for him. So far, not bad. Newton again, quarterback draw. This kid has talent.
Yeah.
And Steve Spurrier says it's really a shame. But when he came here, Newton saw the handwriting on the wall, so to speak, and went to wide receiver because he knew he wasn't Steve Spurrier's prototype quarterback. But Spurrier says now he wished he'd had a chance to work with him a little more because this kid can play.
Yeah, and he is. He can throw the football much better. He's got a nice overhand delivery. Was a pitcher growing up playing baseball, pitcher in high school, and he's got a nice high release. And Steve Spurrier loves him as a playmaker. I mean, he's got a dynamic personality that the other players really respond to as well.
Boyd. And that time they went right behind the right side of that line. Yeah. Seth Edwards, the guard, gave him a nice block and opened up a hole. And Boyd just picking up five at a time.
Yeah, they are working the right side. Sorensen, Pavlovic. Nice block in there by the left right guard. Seth Edwards pulling out in front of the play. And again, this is what South Carolina needs to do. Possess the football, chew up clock.
Run six plays in this drive. They've all been runs. Four-man rush against Newton, plenty of time. Down the middle and overthrown. Flags come down. That's going to be interference inside the five-yard line. Could be on Antoine Stewart as he had contact with Sidney Rice, their go-to guy.
Well, the contact is on Stewart, and because they've run so well, the safety, Hefney, was behind the play. See, he was up there looking at the run, so Newton had a good position to throw that ball down the middle of the field.
Pass interference, number 24, defense. 15-yard penalty, first down.
Wasn't much, but it was there.
Yeah. Well, you run the football, and then you try to get it to your playmaker, Sidney Rice. One-on-one coverage. The safety's up there nosing around the run. He's late getting over, and Stewart makes contact as the ball's in the air. Sidney Rice is going to get that call. I mean, he's an All-American type receiver, and he's going to get that call. But it's the success of the running game that took the safety out of play on that deep post route and gave him a chance to make a play.
Rice is one of those guys good at everything as a high school senior. He was the state high school basketball player of the year, averaged 18 points and 7 rebounds, has a 36-inch vertical jump to go with his 6'4 frame.
Empty backfield now for Newton.
Blitz coming. Right up the middle. Oh, what a nice little head and shoulder fake by Savelle Newton for a first down.
Now, we've already seen a design and called quarterback draw. That's not what this was. This was a case of Savelle Newton knowing he only had five blockers and Tennessee was bringing a blitz. So there was one unblocked guy, so he took off on his own. It was not a design quarterback draw, but that's what it amounted to because Savelle Newton knew pressure was coming. And this is the threat that he gives you. They spread him out by formation. They open up seams for Savelle Newton, and he's an excellent runner.
I thought his game against Auburn was brilliant. Nearly pulled off the upset. If it hadn't been for a drop pass, they'd have had it tied late in the game.
Same formation here.
And now Newton trying to beat the play clock.
He didn't. The flag is down in the end zone. I think that's the second delay of game that they're going to get called on Savelle Newton. Well, they're going to give it to him, I think.
There's no foul for the game. Before the delay of game, first charge timeout, South Carolina.
Of course, that's a big penalty to pay for not being ready as well. Timeouts are precious, but South Carolina with an impressive drive here. Back in Columbia, South Carolina, Tennessee with the early lead, but the Gamecocks are driving. first down at the 11-yard line. So they can get a first down just inside the one.
Red zone has been a problem area for them.
Newton with good time takes off. And gets to about the nine. Covered by Antonio Reynolds from his defensive end spot.
We showed you that red zone number in the two losses to Georgia and Auburn, 1-for-7 when they've been down in scoring territory. Overall, last in the SEC. Very uncharacteristic for Steve Spurrier. I mean, he is a guy that when he was head coach of Florida, they were dynamic in the red zone because they were aggressive, they attacked with their passing game. Little different situation here at South Carolina in his first 2 years, but need a score here. Touchdowns, not field goals.
Newton with time, little crossing pattern, thrown to Mike West, the former linebacker. He's brought down by Wardlow.
Nice job by South Carolina picking up the blitz. South Carolina trying to come after Newton. A lot of time, good protection to pick up the crossing route. And then a nice tackle in the open field by Wardlow. West has great speed, but a very sure tackle by Wardlow. We've got some confusion again personnel-wise for South Carolina, and the play clock down to 11. They're going to have to call another timeout.
Well, these are mistakes that can really cost you late in the half. Remember, if you want to challenge something, the coach has one challenge throughout the course of a game. You have to have a timeout left in that half to utilize the challenge. Let's go to Holly Rowe. Holly?
Guys, Steve Spurrier was telling the signaler what play, and as he did, Andy Boyd, the tight end, ran out on the field. Spurrier went, what? He wasn't supposed to, so he had a little chat with Andy Boyd, but before he did it, I saw him take a big, deep breath, calm himself down before he told Andy Boyd what the real play was and that he wasn't supposed to run out there. Spurrier's trying to keep his cool despite some of their offensive miscues right now.
All right, thanks, Holly.
That's a good observation, Holly, and I think the reason that he wanted to keep his cool is because he knows this is such an important call. I mean, he had to burn another timeout. And so he communicates to Boyd that he wasn't supposed to be on there, but he knows, I mean, this is a critical call right now for him and for his offense. They put a very impressive drive together after the turnover, and they give up the easy score. Now they're right down there on the 5-yard line, but they can't settle for field goals and hope to beat Tennessee tonight.
And Andy Boyd is one of those kids you'd like to see something good happen to. He's gotten a sixth year of eligibility from the NCAA. That's rare enough in itself. He had been out with a fractured shoulder, played in only 12 games over the last 3 years, had two severe knee injuries on plays where he was never touched. So he has had a star-crossed career here at South Carolina.
Well, the question here, will John Chavis come after Savell Newton in the shotgun? He did once, and Savell Newton ran up the middle against the defense.
They need to reach the one for a first down. Newton throws on the run, tipped again, and intercepted by Jonathan Wade. Holy cow. Almost caught by Corey Boyd off the tip.
Well, that's a mistake for Savell Newton. I mean, he's got to try to get it in the end zone. If he can't, then he's just got to, you know, settle for 3 points. I thought he was over the line of scrimmage when he threw it. He was very close, and the ball was tipped, and Wade comes down with the interception. Yeah, you want 7 instead of 3, but you definitely want 3 instead of 0 when you get down there.
Especially after a 74-yard drive that took 5.5 minutes off the clock and took 10 plays. They get nothing out of it, but they have shown one thing, that they can move the ball on the ground against Tennessee. And Stewart is the injured player for the Volunteers. We'll check on his condition when we come back. 7-0, Tennessee. Tennessee's defense has done the job so far. They have a touchdown on an interception return, an interception that stopped the touchdown drive for South Carolina. Stewart was the injured player, able to come off under his own power. And Tennessee's offense gets the football for the first time from the 20. Eric Gaines, the quarterback, to throw. Hit as he throws, and it's incomplete.
Well, Tennessee, the number one passing offense in the SEC behind Eric Ainge. His receivers, Robert Meacham, has been his go-to guy, averaging over 100 yards per game in receiving yards. Brett Smith might have to step up tonight a little bit more. He's been the number three receiver, but Jason Swain a little banged up. And Arian Foster comes back into the starting lineup with the injury to LaMarcus Coker, a more physical runner, not the same speed that Coker had.
Foster started the first two, then missed three with an ankle injury, and Coker was in there. Turns the corner, first down and more up to the 45-yard line.
That's Brett Smith getting more involved in the offense. Again, Jason Swain, an injured left ankle, no practice this week. He's normally the slot receiver, Smith, a well-designed reverse, a fast flow defense in South Carolina. Get him running one way and come the reverse back early in the ball game, just to kind of send a message, misdirection message to South Carolina.
Spotted to 45 for a first down. Foster, nothing. In fact, may have lost a yard as Jasper Brinkley got it. Let's take a look at the starting lineups presented by the U.S. Postal Service. Yes, Tennessee's passing game is terrific, but they do need to run the ball better. It's time for that inexperienced offensive line to improve.
Strength of that offensive line, their two tackles, Aaron Sears, the left tackle and All-American candidate. Eric Young on the right side really coming on and matching the play of Sears on the left side.
Meacham in momentum back or motion back to the formation. He'll get the little toss out in the flat. Got away from Brinkley. Gets down to the South Carolina 41-yard line. Brad Cottom, a good block for him, the tight end.
It's a nice job by Eric Ainge. When you run a bootleg, a naked bootleg as a quarterback, the key thing is you must get your head and eyes around. You've got to see where the pressure's coming from. If he doesn't get his eyes around, there's no way he gets the ball quick enough to Meacham. And Meacham does a great job of getting his hands on the football and then turning upfield. A lot of yards after the catch for Robert Meacham this year. Big and fast.
He is third in the country in receiving yards, almost 109 a game. Foster dragging a tackler with him to the 39. Captain Munnerlin would not let go. Gamecock secondary has been up and down this year. Fred Bennett, one of the SEC's best, but he will be challenged by Tennessee's passing game tonight, especially when he's matched up with Meacham.
And some youth in that secondary. Bennett, the only experienced guy, 28 starts coming into the game tonight. The key is not just the coverage, but pressure on quarterback Eric Ainge, making him as uncomfortable as South Carolina can.
South Carolina comes with a blitz. Little toss to Meacham. Not much in front, or Foster rather, and he's knocked out of bounds inside the 30. Let's go to Reese Davis.
All right, Mike, Taco Bell studio update. You know, number three's already gone down on the road. Number five, Texas in Lubbock to take on Texas Tech. Colt McCoy, just his third interception since the Ohio State game. Fletcher Session, a pick six. It's 21-7 Red Raiders.
Some real surprises today, things you really didn't expect were coming.
Well, Arian Foster, who missed three games with an ankle, has hobbled himself off the field again. Hardesty now, the number three back in.
Coker is out at least a month. There goes Hardesty. Yeah. The cupboard is not bare. Nope. He's down to the six. Got a great block from his freshman center, Josh McNeil.
David Cutcliffe told us at their hotel last night, we've got to get our backs involved and our tight ends early in the passing game. So much attention to our wide receivers. We've seen a couple swings. This time, just a setup screen. Good blocking out in front. South Carolina is so concerned with the wideouts of Tennessee, not paying attention to the backs coming out of the backfield right now.
First and goal, Volunteers. Flags are down.
Flag on the play.
Before the snap, false start. Number 76, offense. 5-yard penalty, first down.
That's the guy who's in line for all the awards. Aaron Sears. 6'4", 320, and he can run.
He's first and goal now from the 11.
That'll move it back to the 11, first and goal. Foster trying to shake it off. Hardesty on the draw. The power runner takes it down near the 7. Let's go to Holly. What do we have on Foster?
Guys, Arian Foster is complaining about that left ankle. What they're doing right now is actually changing the ankle brace he is wearing. They got a new one out of the equipment bin, and they will redo that. Also, Antoine Stewart complaining of some pain and discomfort in his sternum. He's trying to shake it off and will likely return.
All right, thanks, Holly. Second and goal. The receivers to the left side. Fake the end around. Hardesty.
Well, this has been
because he got to the 5, and it was Jasper Brinkley in the middle.
And this has been the kind of the weak spot for the Tennessee offense. And they've got good numbers. They're averaging over 400 yards a game, but it's been so heavy pass, they just have not run the ball consistently this season. And in our close games, they haven't run it very well at all. The one loss to Florida, minus 11 yards rushing. They beat Alabama last week, but only 57 yards rushing on 21 carries.
South Carolina changing a lot of personnel on third and goal. Some of them just getting in position now. Ainge fakes the play to Hardesty. Plenty of time. Now throws in the end zone.
You can't.
South Carolina players had a shot at the interception, and as it is, Cook and Woods have knocked it away from each other, and it's a Tennessee touchdown. Are you kidding? Poor decision by Ainge to throw that ball. There was not a volunteer receiver anywhere near it. What a break for Tennessee. And they may want to look at this.
Well, we saw a tip in the end zone that resulted in interception. This looked like an interception for sure. You were right. Bad decision by Ainge, throwing back to the middle of the field. What are they looking at?
Looked like Smith had it. Well, the ball did hit the ground, and it bobbled some. It's all right if it hits the ground, if you maintain possession. But the officials will look at that. If they see the ball move, they may say he did not have possession.
Well, again, the call on the field was touchdown, so it has to be indisputable video evidence to change the call.
Or touchback. No, touchdown.
Touchdown.
They got turned around again.
Be surprised if they change this one. But boy, we've seen some
further
funny bounces.
The play stands as called on the field. Touchdown.
Smith gets his third touchdown catch of the year. This one couldn't be much stranger right now. Will Height for the point after. 10 plays, 80 yards. Can Newton bring them back? South Carolina down early, first quarter. Back in Columbia, South Carolina, Florida a winner this afternoon. They go to 5-1 in the SEC East. Tennessee the only pursuer with just one loss. South Carolina at 3-2, playing Tennessee and Florida still to go. So they actually control their own destiny. Two wins, and they would be in first place with the tiebreakers. But it may be a tall order tonight. They're already down 14-0. Munter Allen and Thomas are deep for Wilhoit's kick. And this one will go out of bounds. South Carolina will get great field position on that kicking mistake.
Well, the game's been a game of funny bounces so far tonight. First possession, Savelle Newton. This was a good throw. I don't put this on the quarterback as much as the receiver, Mike West. Jonathan Wade rips it out. Marvin Mitchell takes it in for the touchdown. And then this one was Savelle trying to create a little too much creativity. And Jonathan Wade with the interception. And this one should have been an interception and resulted in a touchdown. So the bounce is certainly going the way of the Volunteers here in the first quarter. As if Tennessee needed any help in this game. I mean, they are a team on a real roll since their loss to Florida and up 14 right now.
South Carolina moved the ball well the last time they had it. Flag is down, and so is Newton. He'll lose about a yard. We'll check the penalty. The tackle made by West Brown, number 94, as they rotate ends and tackles out of that defensive line to keep everybody fresh.
Offsides, number 90, defense, lined up in the neutral zone. 5-yard penalty, repeat, first down.
That's Turt McBride, their best lineman, who was offside.
Ball is now placed on the 40 for Carolina.
Well, if you're South Carolina, you come back and try to do the same thing you did in the last drive. Just try to run it as much as you can.
Run the football. I mean, they had success doing that. I think they got to try to get number 4 involved a little bit. Play action, try to get the ball to Sidney Rice. He's up here at the top of the screen right now. Get him involved.
Mike Davis, number 25, is checked in at the running back spot. Instead, they'll fake the screen one way and go to Corey Boyd the other way.
It was a nice job by Sidney Rice turning into a blocker that time. The screen, fake one way, come back the other way to Boyd, and Sidney Rice gets a key block to secure the first down. Nice execution by Newton. And out on the outside, Sidney Rice gets the first down for Boyd. Working on Stewart. Good to see Stewart back in the game.
Newton trying to change the play. Boyd again. Nice cut and another first down down to the 37-yard line. Wade has to make the tackle, and he has really run well.
And they have found something on the left side of the Tennessee defense. That's where they're exploiting. Take a look at South Carolina's offense the first two games compared to the last five. A lot of that due to the Savelle Newton being named the starting quarterback. Look at the third down. That to me is the biggest change. With Savelle Newton in the game, they have possessed the football by converting third downs over 50% because of his ability to create with his legs or his arm.
Boyd averaging 7 yards a carry, 49 yards on 7 drives. Got about 5 on that one.
Well, it's interesting because this Tennessee defense last week went against Ken Darby of Alabama, who was coming into the game back-to-back 100-yard games. They held him to 26 yards on 14 carries. Corey Boyd back-to-back 100-yard games against Kentucky and Vanderbilt coming into tonight's game, and he's off to a very fast start here in the first half against John Chavis's defense.
Well, you have to respect Newton, and he puts that ball in Boyd's belly, and it's just like an any option read.
Yep.
And they're trying to pay attention to Newton, and Boyd is eating them up. Now Davis goes in. He slips a tackle. Picks up a couple, and the linebacker, Gerard Mayo, makes the stop. Mayo burst on the national scene against California when they slugged them. 3 sacks, 2 tackles for loss. He was the national player of the week in that roughing up of California.
He's had an ankle problem that he's just now getting 100% back from. He had a week off before the Alabama game, and against Alabama, 12 tackles and a sack. He was the SEC Player of the Week on the defensive side.
See if South Carolina will get a playoff before the quarter ends, and they've decided not to. That's the end of the first 15 minutes here in Columbia, 14-0 Tennessee. Welcome back to Columbia, South Carolina. Both of these teams chasing the Florida Gators in the SEC East. Florida with one loss. Neither one of these clubs can afford a defeat here tonight to maintain their position.
Well, we mentioned the improvement for South Carolina on third down with Newton in the game. They're 0 for 1 tonight.
Newton bobbles the snap. It cost him any chance of getting the first down.
Now, this was just a case of Savelle being in too big of a hurry. I mean, this was his number called to run the option, but he took off before he had the ball secured. It's a matter of doing first things first, and maybe Savelle pressing a little bit too much right now. It's a big game for him. He knows it.
They're going to go for it, Todd. Yeah.
Well, they're in Suckup's range for sure. He kicked a 55-yarder last week. But I think Steve Spurrier wants to try to get closer to that end zone. Oh, my goodness, another timeout.
They're all gone. They've used all their timeouts here. We have 14:20 to go in the half, and the old ball coach is not happy with that. We'll see if they still go for it when we come back to South Carolina. Smokey, the Tennessee mascot. It's election season, remember, and we have Smokey Gate. And we will have Holly Rowe investigating momentarily. They've changed their mind, and Suckup will try a 50-yard field goal. He's hit from 55 this year. He's only missed from 51. Kid is good.
He is good.
He's doing all the kicking duties this year for the first time in his career. South Carolina gets on the board with a big field goal.
I think it's a good decision by Steve. Your offense has moved the ball some. You got to have something to show for it, some points.
More on Smokey Gate. Here's Holly Rowe.
Well, guys, it was an alleged incident that took place last week before the Alabama game. A player was warming up, an Alabama player, and supposedly kind of landed on Smokey. Well, the Alabama people are saying that he was bitten. The Tennessee people, not quite so sure. Mike Shula said there was blood drawn, but because the player's a freshman, the media hasn't been allowed to verify that story. I spoke with the Smokies handlers. They said nothing has come of the incident and that this is really a good, friendly dog. They really test these dogs because they have to be around a lot of kids, around a lot of people coming up, putting their hands in his face. So this has proven to be a pretty people-friendly dog so far, but the handler did say, hey, any good coonhound worth his weight would respond if landed on. So that's their story, and they're sticking to it.
Well, Holly, players respond. Why wouldn't a dog?
Yeah, well, especially if it was an Alabama player. I mean, you know, that rivalry runs deep.
I don't think that'd be a fair matchup with Gamecock. Got to look out for those talons, though. What a weapon. Knocked it into the hedges. Let's check in with Reese Davis. He has a Sports Center 30 at 30.
All right, Mike, the dominant story, the number three team in the land, USC, rallied at Oregon State. But when that two-point conversion attempt went awry, the Beavers upset the Trojans 33-31, first Pac-10 loss in 28 games. First day he can, Barry Bonds files for free agency a day after the World Series. More on that story. Sports Center coming up after the game. ESPN News always on your cable system.
All right, Reese, thanks very much. Sometimes you don't have to solve the puzzle. The puzzle solves itself. With Southern Cal losing this afternoon, Foster is back in there. He'll get the carry on the handoff from Ainge. And South Carolina playing the run very strongly tonight.
Well, they commit a lot of guys to the run, but they don't line up and show you where they're coming from. They're not very big, the South Carolina defense. So they can't just line up and say, hey, bring it at us. They've got to move around, use their quickness, change their alignments. Tyrone Nix, defensive coordinator, got his training at Southern Miss, and this style of defense has been pretty popular. When you have undersized guys, but you have speed, move them around and confuse the offense.
And they began this year with 10 new starters in this unit. Ainge, plenty of time, throws underneath. That one will be complete to Meacham. Didn't get much and then dragged out of bounds.
Eric Ainge really struggled in the first half last week against Alabama. Three interceptions, his mechanics kind of got goofy, was forcing some balls, but he looks pretty comfortable tonight throwing the football. Good protection, Meacham his go-to guy. He's got a big body, so he can shield that defender. Munderlin was in decent position, but Meacham at 6'3", 215 pounds, able to shield the defender away.
Foster picks up nearly five before Emmanuel Cook stood him up.
You know, Eric Ainge is a different quarterback completely than he was a year ago. Look at those numbers and look at the completion percentage, yards per game, everything dramatically up. And I attribute that to David Cutcliffe. Got a hold of him in the spring and got him to just change the way he practiced, the way he worked. He worked on his fundamentals. His footwork is much better this year, and that's why he's a more accurate quarterback.
He has produced some tremendous passes. Foster again, room to run this time, and he's out to the 41-yard line, got a first down. Eric Young pulled from his right tackle spot, threw him a good block.
We're talking about Eric Ainge and his footwork and the improvement in his footwork. A lot of people don't realize that being an accurate quarterback and throwing the ball accurately has more to do with your feet than it does your arm. It's all about getting your body in the good position, being on balance, not overstriding. And if your body's in the right spot, the ball's going to go where you want it to go. And he had really gotten poor mechanic-wise last year.
Five out of six for 63 yards so far. Now make it six out of seven. And Swain is into the ball game, and he gets the catch down to the 46-yard line. Swain has been bothered by an ankle injury, but has more than 100 career catches for this program.
He had three catches in the first half last week and then had to be taken out. Couldn't finish the game because he re-aggravated that left ankle injury. Didn't practice at all this week. He was at, he had one of those boots on at the hotel last night, but looks pretty good running around there tonight.
Foster breaks a tackle. Dives forward to the 42. And it looks right now like that South Carolina defense is already a little bit tired.
Mm-hmm. A defense that maybe doesn't have the same kind of depth that a Tennessee defense has right now. Their guys have to play a little bit longer, more reps. But they play hard for Tyrone Nix, and they use their speed and their quickness to their full advantage.
Just brought in two new tackles. Neither one of which weighs 280. Foster again. Pursuit from the backside gets him, and he's stopped at the line of scrimmage by Eric Norwood.
We got a couple really talented young freshmen. Eric Norwood is one of them, a true freshman out of Ackworth, Georgia, played at North Cobb High School. He's their leading sacker. He's not a very big guy, defensive end, 6'2", 250 pounds. But he's got good acceleration, good explosion. And he's made a real impact on this South Carolina defense.
They could certainly use a hold here on third and seven. Flag is down. They'll whistle the play dead. Usually that means something on the offense.
Well, might have a delay of game on Tennessee now.
Before the snap. False start, number 66, offense. 5-yard penalty, still third down.
David Ligon, the 6'5 senior, whistled for five. And Philip Fulmer, being the former offensive lineman, doesn't like those guys making mistakes.
Well, that's a mental mistake, but that's a big mistake because now you go from third and seven to third and 12, and then there's a big difference. You look at Tennessee's third down conversions, outstanding this season, but third and 12, is a whole lot tougher than third and seven. Third and 12 allows you as a defense to play maybe a little more zone and try to keep things in front of you, try to force an underneath throw and then make a tackle out in space.
Taylor, number 12, Briscoe, number 81, are in as additional wide receivers for Tennessee. Four-man rush. Ainge now flushed. This is not what he does best. And he's brought down by Jasper Brinkley, the junior college transfer.
Big stop for South Carolina's defense. They were aided by the penalty, but they had good downfield coverage that time. A four-man rush forced Eric Ainge to leave the pocket, and they forced a punt.
Now, Britton Colquitt will come on. Of the kicking Colquitts, Craig, Jimmy, and Dustin all preceded him at Tennessee. And those four Colquitts have the top four career averages ever in Volunteer history. McKinley is deep. And Colquitt just crushed that one. It's only a net of 23 as they'll bring it out to the 20-yard line. Will South Carolina be able to move the ball again? They've moved it well so far, they just can't score very much. This is Steve Spurrier's office. There's some great memorabilia in there, particularly this one, the game ball from the 31-26 win over Tennessee in Knoxville in 1988 with Duke. It was his second year as the Blue Devils head coach, and he's the only coach in NCAA history to win at Tennessee to do it with three different teams. So he has been a thorn in their side forever. Newton. Great escapability in Savelle Newton out to the 26 before he's drilled by Marvin Mitchell. Let's go to Reese Davis.
Mike, in 2002 and 03, Texas and Texas Tech played a couple of shootouts in which the teams combined for 80 points. And looks like we're on our way there this time. 24-21 Tech. Graham Harrell to Jared Hicks. 31-21. We're at halftime in Lubbock.
We can only imagine Mac Brown's not real happy.
How about Gene Chizik, the defensive coordinator?
Newton gets it out to McKinley, and McKinley stretches out to the 31.
Kenny McKinley has really developed as the second receiver and has really, in the last several weeks, been the go-to guy for Savelle Newton. So much attention being paid to Sidney Rice. Kenny McKinley had a huge game, his first 100-yard game in the Auburn game, 8 catches, 110 yards, but he's averaging over 17 yards a catch and has really been a nice complement to Rice. They just still need to develop that third receiver to be really effective in their passing game.
Newton out to the sideline, and nice play by Corey Boyd. He's tough to bring down. The first guy hasn't had much success with him.
I'm impressed with Corey Boyd. I mean, he is a guy who, over the last several weeks, has played extremely well. Back-to-back 100-yard games as a rusher. Breaks tackles. I mean, he's not a real big guy. He's listed at 6'1", 200 pounds, but has some strength and ability to break tackles.
He wanted to play running back coming out of high school out of Orange, New Jersey, in a very violent and dangerous neighborhood. Nobody else but South Carolina gave him a chance to play running back. Then he was suspended for a year for a violation of team rules. Wanted to go home, and his mom said, uh-uh, you're staying down there. Yeah! Nice throw by Newton, complete to McKinley in Tennessee territory. Jonathan Hefty made the tackle.
It's a nice read by Savelle Newton because they swung Boyd out in the same position, and he was covered, and that opened things up for McKinley on the corner route. Because they covered the underneath throw where Boyd was, Newton read it, threw over the top to the corner to McKinley. Good timing and a good read by Savelle Newton.
Well, this drive, they've really come out throwing as opposed to the other ones where they tried to establish the ground game. They've been very effective at both, much more effective than the scoreboard would indicate.
Steve's changing this one from the sideline because Tennessee is showing blitz, so they're changing the play from the sideline.
Here comes the pressure. Newton hangs in the pocket. Downfield and complete to the 20-yard line to Rice.
Tie goes to the receiver if they rule it a tie.
Rice had a couple of steps.
Yes, it was. I mean, but Newton had to get rid of it because it was a full blitz that Steve recognized from the sideline. So Newton's got to get rid of it, and it's slightly underthrown and back to the inside. But Rice saw the ball the whole way. The defender did not see the football, never picked it up. Marsalis Johnson, a freshman, was in good position but had no idea where the football was. And a big play versus the blitz by Newton to Rice.
Well, you gotta like Newton. He knew he was gonna get popped, and he just hung in there and made the throw. He has made a tremendous difference in this offense. And Todd, you're right. He throws the ball a lot better than people would think for a running quarterback.
Another blitz.
Newton takes off late. He gets maybe a yard.
See, here's the thing that's interesting. With the exception of a few called quarterback runs, Steve Spurrier is not calling different plays for Sydell Newton. He's calling the same plays he would call if Blake Mitchell was the quarterback, the more passing-oriented quarterback. The difference is he's not overcoaching Sydell Newton. He's not doing as many audibles with him because he wants Sydell to be creative. If it's not there, if he doesn't like what he sees, take off and run. Make a play with your leg. So he's calling the same plays, and Sydell can execute the same plays, but he also has that green light to make something happen with his legs if he doesn't like what he sees.
And he seems to be a much better fit with that inexperienced offensive line. Mm-hmm. Boy, that was low.
Yeah.
And on the short passes, nothing downfield, but on the short passes, he's got a hitch in his delivery.
Well, he's a little bit of an overstrider. I mean, he doesn't have a beautiful motion because he overstrides a little bit. He's got a nice overhand delivery, but watch his stride. He dips that back leg, and he kind of strides out a little bit too far, and that affects his accuracy some on those shorter throws.
And Boyd had some room to operate had he been able to come up with that. Third and nine.
Tennessee showing pressure again.
Newton with room. Now he throws on the run. Touchdown.
What a play.
Sydell Newton to Mike West, the former linebacker, with his first touchdown. And that was Newton's mobility and his escapability. He got out on the perimeter and found a wide open receiver.
If you don't like what it looks like from the pocket, get out and make something happen on your own. He tried it down in the red zone and threw an interception, but credit this guy's courage, his confidence to come back and do the same thing and this time make it pay off.
He is very accurate throwing the ball on the run. And the point after makes it 14-10. That was a third down, and when we come back, Todd will break down why Sydell Newton is so dangerous on those third down plays. Sydell Newton accounted for 80 yards in total offense on that drive. He ran for 7, passed for 73.
Well, I'm going to show you what Sydell Newton does now, and this is what makes him dangerous. As he goes back in the pocket, he's not going to like what he sees. He doesn't have anything right here. But here's Mike West, and Mike West is going to move with his quarterback and go to the end zone, and that's where Sydell's going to pick him up as he creates out of the pocket and throws a touchdown. But it's all based on Sydell Newton creating on his own.
And we have a 4-point ball game. Tennessee on the return out to the 21-yard line, Marcellus Johnson. And they'll start from there.
Well, we mentioned South Carolina's third down conversions have skyrocketed with Newton at quarterback because he can leave the pocket and create either as a thrower or a runner. This was third and 13 against Vanderbilt last week. He has nobody open, but he sees some space in the middle of the field. So what's he do? He leaves the pocket and he takes off as a runner. You got a guy third and 13, and he runs for 15 for a first down. I mean, you got no chance. And he just converted another third down and threw a touchdown against Tennessee.
Foster is back in there for Tennessee. Ainge fakes it to him and then comes back and throws to Meacham across the 30 out of bounds to 33. Three catches for the All-American candidate.
And Eric Ainge looks much more comfortable tonight in the first half than he did against Alabama. Again, his footwork got kind of out of skewed or off skewed or whatever you want to, however you say that. How would I say that?
It wasn't skewed.
It was not skewed. It was not skewed last week. But this week he looks sharp.
You have to wonder if Sydell Newton had started the season where that offense would be. That's Ainge's dad, Doug. Of course, he has famous Uncle Danny Ainge. Foster on the screen. Good hustle by the South Carolina defense. They get to him at the 39-yard line. Here's Reese Davis.
All right, Mike, you know, the only team in the SEC without a loss in conference play is Arkansas. Now, Arkansas stepping out of conference to play Louisiana Monroe. That's Darren McFadden, who got the direct snap, threw it to Wes Murphy for the touchdown. Hogs are rolling, 23-7.
That's pretty good football.
That's it, and they're getting better each week.
Yes,
we'll see them here next week in South Carolina.
Second and four for Tennessee. Foster on the delay. Nice cut. Midfield first down. Looked like there was nothing there, and a little shifty move picked him up 5 yards.
And just a little hesitation. David Cutcliffe said he has excellent vision. Sometimes too good. Sometimes he sees too many guys. But that time he did a nice job of feeling where the guys were coming from, setting up some blockers, and tacking on extra yardage.
Tennessee at midfield. Clock running, under 4 minutes to go, first half. And he's got a block from Foster.
Nice, nice throw.
Good throw. But out of bounds?
Now, the tight end did not know where the sideline was. Brad Cottom was the receiver, and he was in good position, but I don't think he knew where the sideline was.
And it would have come back on the penalty anyway.
6'8", junior. Oh, wow, I think his left foot was down.
Sure was.
There is a flag down.
Holding, number 66, offense.
Doesn't matter.
10-yard penalty. Repeat first down.
David Ligon, but they would have reviewed that and changed it to a catch.
Yeah, he got his left foot down. I was getting on the big tight end that he didn't know where the sideline was. He knew exactly where it was. Beautiful throw by Ainge. Left foot down, right foot out of bounds, but left foot down when he had the catch.
Foster. Now that's hustle. Joel Reeves, number 98, the nose tackle, whiffed, got right back up and made the stop.
Joel Reeves getting the start in there tonight. There's the whiff, but you're right, gets right back up. As soon as Foster starts moving laterally, Reeves is there to get him from behind.
Yep, don't lay there and look bad. Get up and make a play, and he did. Second and 18. Foster in the flat. Good play out there by Carlos Thomas. Cut his knees out from under him. Let's go to Holly.
Hey guys, Savelle Newton, the quarterback for South Carolina, didn't have much of a chance to celebrate that last touchdown. He took a couple of hard hits, one particularly to the helmet on that drive. He came to the sideline and he keeps shaking his head like he's trying to shake the cobwebs out. He finally summoned the trainers over. He's had an extensive evaluation by trainer Bill Martin. So far it looks like he's okay, guys, but we'll keep our eye on it. They certainly need him at his best tonight.
Now that was one of the first plays of that drive when he hit Marvin Mitchell when he scrambled up the middle. That was very early on in that scoring drive.
Third and 13, another big play. Ainge scrambling, throws on the run, and complete through the hands of Foster. He had him.
He sure did. That was a good bit of improvising by Eric Ainge. We've talked about Savelle Newton moving out of the pocket and creating. That's exactly what Eric Ainge did. Eric Ainge, a pretty good athlete by his own right, excellent baseball and basketball player, moves, buys time, keeps his eyes downfield, and that should have been a catch and another third down conversion for Tennessee.
Well, it looked like the ball got on top of Foster before he was ready for it, but he needed to be ready for it. Colquitt to kick, and McKinley will try to return it. Tripped up as he got to the 12, 13-yard line. Let's go to Reese Davis. Reese, what do you have?
All right, Mike, coming up in the Pontiac Performance Halftime Report, number three goes on the road and falls. Number five is in a world of trouble down in Lubbock. And Georgia started, or rather Florida started off as if things were going to be easy against Georgia. We'll show you how the Gators had to hang on for dear life at the end. Mark and Lou will join me. We'll see you at halftime.
Okay, Reese, thanks very much.
Yeah, there aren't too many blowouts in that game that was formerly known as the world's largest outdoor cocktail party.
I was there for a few of those, and it was. I helped. Clock running, South Carolina with no timeouts, remember. Boyd on the delay gets up to 15. And from where they're starting, they would be content, I would think, to run the clock out.
Matt McLaughlin for Tennessee. It'll be second and nine, ball is on the 14.
Yeah, Steve Spurrier has to be pleased with the fact that they've been able to claw their way back in this game. And,
if you're Tennessee, don't you think about using your timeouts?
Yeah, I think you would. Maybe try to get after a punt if you could.
Newton on a designed run going up to the 19-yard line.
Can't carry him over. They don't roll over.
No. And it seems like Tennessee will be content as well. And Newton just looking toward the sideline, letting the clock wind down. Could be the last play of the half. Boyd taken down at the 23-yard line, very close to the first down stick. Right at the yellow line. I am surprised Tennessee didn't use its timeouts to at least force South Carolina to kick the ball back to them. All sorts of things can happen on a punt, a bad snap, a block, a big return.
Well, they had a block punt in their big win against Georgia in that second half. One of their many big plays in the second half of that game.
Now they won't have to snap it once the ball's marked ready for play. The clock will run. And that'll be the end of the first half as South Carolina has come back to make it only a four-point game. Let's go down to Holly Rowe.
Hey, Coach Spurrier, after that first play of the game, a turnover for score, what went through your mind?
Oh, we had two tip balls. They got both of them. So, but we're back in the game, so, you know, we just gotta go play.
How do you think your offense regrouped?
Oh, they did well. Well, and our defense made some stops, so we're in the game.
All right, thanks, Coach.
Great to listen to, isn't he? Our halftime score, Tennessee 14, South Carolina 10. Now let's join Reese Davis in the...
Here at Columbia, second half coming up. Volunteers led 14-0. Gamecocks got off the canvas to score 10 points. South Carolina, very generous tippers. They tipped the ball into an interception, tipped the ball, should have been a touchdown, fell into a hole, but rallied behind Savelle Newton.
Well, first of all, Tennessee's got to come out smoking again. David Cutcliffe and Eric Ainge have got to throw the football and keep running draws and screens. Especially, they got to go deep outside and deep in the middle. They've got to stretch the defense. They're throwing nickel and dime stuff, but they got to try to get a big one.
You know, the thing that's killing Tennessee is what we knew would hurt them coming in, their inability to run the football consistently. Yeah. 64 yards running the football. I don't think the balance there is enough to be able to slow down the pass rush from South Carolina. But as I said all day long, Savelle Newton, the X factor, what I love, and I'm sure Todd's been talking about, is he scrambles not only to pick up yardage, scrambling to buy time and then throwing the ball downfield. That's the key for Savelle Newton here in the second half.
Penalties hurt their attempts to extend the lead in the second quarter. They'll get the ball to start the second half. Back upstairs to Mike and Todd.
All right, Chris, thanks very much. And here's the Principal Financial Group first half stats. And maybe a little bit of an eye-opener that South Carolina has outgained Tennessee in this ball game, particularly 93-65 rushing. And if you take away those couple of breaks that Tennessee had on tip balls. This is an entirely different football game.
Yeah, the turnover is really the difference in the game so far for Tennessee. And credit to South Carolina that Savelle Newton in particular has overcome those turnovers. Yeah. He's come back. He played very well down the stretch there in the first half. And so South Carolina right back in the ball game.
They had to be very encouraged by the fact that they were down 14-0. Didn't panic.
Yeah.
They were able to move the ball a couple of drives. They ran great.
Yeah, I think they ran the ball well that first half, the whole first half. And I think that'll be one of the big differences to see what does John Chavis do defensively to slow down the South Carolina running game, because they had some problems stopping it in the first half.
The numbers on Newton, 70% completions, 84 yards. Just his mobility is such a huge factor for this offense. Tennessee will get the ball to start the second half. And that's the second kicking mistake we have seen in this ball game.
Well, Savelle Newton in the first half, he got off to a slow start. Two of his first three passes were intercepted. The first one was not really his fault, but it resulted in a Tennessee touchdown. And then trying to create, tip ball, intercepted, took away a scoring threat. But then he settled down and really started to become a big-time difference maker in the game. Through this touchdown, creating on the move, made some nice scrambles, a couple designed runs, a couple runs on his own. And South Carolina right back in the football game.
With a kick out of bounds, Tennessee will start from its 35. Ainge in the shotgun, fakes it to Foster, goes out to Smith, flanker screen. And Smith, with all that effort, will get maybe a yard.
That was really well defended by Jasper Brinkley, or actually Casper Brinkley, the defensive end, and he missed him and came after him again. We've seen a couple South Carolina players do that. Miss on the first tackle, stay with it, and get him the second time.
Jasper and Casper transfers from Georgia Military College, and it was a package deal. One the middle linebacker, one a defensive end. Blitz coming against Ainge. Nowhere to go, and he has to eat it. Emmanuel Jean-Pierre made the tackle. Let's go to Holly Rowe.
Well, guys, I spoke with Tennessee coach Philip Fulmer at halftime, and he said their biggest problem in the first half, they only had 25 snaps. He said that South Carolina's game plan to keep the ball and have a possession game was brilliant, and they did a good job keeping it away. He said the other critical problem was that on key possessions, they had penalties that caused them to go three and out, so they've got to clean it up.
And Holly, that goes back to what Todd was saying. It's to South Carolina's advantage to shorten the game, and they've done it. Here comes a blitz. They want a screen, and they covered it beautifully. South Carolina swarming on defense. Stoney Woodson, the free safety, was all over the screen after the line penetrated.
And I don't know that you could start the third quarter any better if you're Steve Spurrier, if you're Tyrone Nix, the defensive coordinator. Three outstanding plays defensively, and they'll get the ball in good field position. They have struggled that first possession of the third quarter a lot this season. That time they didn't.
Colquitt, who was as good as there is in college football, to kick to McKinley. This one a low line drive, and McKinley with a chance from the 34. And great coverage by Tennessee. They get him at the 35 after a 44-yard kick that Colquitt didn't get much air under. Robert Ayers on special teams hustling downfield to make the tackle for the Volunteers.
Yeah, I thought that was going to be a little bit better opportunity for a return if he goes up the field in north and south, but he started going sideways and ran out of room. Still have to see if South Carolina can get Sidney Rice involved in the game. He was not a factor. Here he is right here on the bottom. Big time receiver. Hasn't been a factor yet tonight.
Newton off of play action. There's Rice. Made the catch at the 47-yard line. Tackled by Jonathan Wade.
And see, that's by design. Steve Spurrier saying, look, Number four is too good of a player for us to play 30 minutes and him not even be involved in the offense. So let's come out early and try to get him involved. He's a big target. He's working hard. Throw him the football, let him make a play. This guy had phenomenal numbers last year as a freshman, and so far in SEC play, he's really struggled. Last week was kind of a breakout game.
He's going to have to go some to match those numbers. Boyd somehow avoided losing 5 yards, actually picked up three before Marvin Mitchell made the tackle. Remember, in the first half, those holes were straight up the middle for Corey Boyd, and he exploited them very well.
John Chavis' defense, they lost their best defensive lineman, Justin Harrell, their defensive tackle and All-American candidate, injured before the Florida game, played the Florida game, torn bicep muscle, but had surgery after that. And there he is on the sideline, still one of the leaders on this team, but he was by far their best interior lineman, but they have really rallied and played well.
Also lost an outstanding corner, Inky Johnson, who is facing surgery himself. Newton hustles, got the first down. Stafford, the fullback, threw him a nice block to get him that extra yardage. Both of these ball clubs chasing the Florida Gators in the SEC East. Florida a winner today in Jacksonville over Georgia. And let's see if Steve Spurrier still has the magic against Philip Fulmer. He has beaten him with three different teams.
Well, that's again, just Savelle Newton, his ability to make a play where there is no play. You can't account for that.
Boyd. Didn't look like there was much there. Still, he got 4 yards before Turk McBride made the tackle. And that South Carolina offensive line had been a problem, but tonight they played very well against the stout Tennessee front.
Well, they've gone right at them. They've run the football at them. They've had success. Newton has been a difference maker because even when they've gotten pressure, they've not been able to corral him. Jamon Meredith playing the left tackle has kind of anchored that side a little bit.
Four wide receivers are in for the Gamecocks. Newton, pressure, got away.
See, that's not supposed to happen. I'm sorry. I mean, when you have pressure right up the middle.
Matt McLaughlin looked like he was just ready to unload.
I mean, this is like grasping after the wind, you know, and then you open your hand, there's nothing there. That's what Matt McLaughlin whiffed. And Savelle Newton takes a sure 7 or 8 yard loss to most quarterbacks and turns it into about a 9 yard gain.
That is a 290-pounder just flying past the quarterback. Third and a yard. Another impressive drive for South Carolina. Boyd. And I tell you what, Gerard Mayo just came up and filled that hole big time.
Yep, he came from the backside and anticipated the snap count. Met the ball carrier behind the line of scrimmage. They gained nothing.
Spurrier not even hesitating. From here, it would be about a 48-49-yard field goal, which is well within Suckup's range. But he's moving the ball right now. South Carolina called timeout.
Well, that's a good thing because
South Carolina.
Savelle Newton dropped the snap.
That would have been an ugly finish to a great drive.
Back in Columbia, the reason that timeout was called, Steve Spurrier called it because, see these guys stacked in the middle, that's four defenders, and there was no fullback in for South Carolina. So it was either a quarterback sneak or an inside run. They didn't have enough guys to block it, and Steve Spurrier wanted to take a second look at it.
See if they try to get Newton on the perimeter here on fourth and a yard and a half.
Same defensive look.
Boyd made the catch. Can he get the first down? No.
Bad pitch.
Sure was.
See, that was a good idea because, again, Tennessee had it stacked in, but because the pitch was behind Boyd, it took away the timing of the play. Boyd had to stop and reach back for the pitch, and he wasn't able to get started fast enough again. See, this was a good call because they were crashing down, but Gerard Mayo forced the bad pitch by the quarterback, Newton.
Boyd Mayo came in from the corner and made him get rid of it in a hurry. Mayo's made some huge plays in this game. Ainge under pressure.
Great throw.
Tight end has it down the sideline.
Great throw under
to midfield.
And again, the bootleg and Eric Ainge getting his head and eyes around to see where his trouble was. If he doesn't get his head around quick, he doesn't know he has to get backpedal and get rid of the football. But because he saw the pressure, he was able to retreat and still make an accurate throw.
And Cottom is a big target, 6'8", 260, and obviously can run a little bit. Play action by Ainge again. And overthrows Meacham. Had him behind Carlos Thomas.
Well, they haven't attacked down the field too much in this game. They took a shot, the deep crossing route, one of Tennessee's favorite routes, and he had a couple steps on Thomas, and it was a pretty good throw, but just a little bit too far to the sideline. Most of the stuff has been underneath, a little dink and dunk stuff, bootlegs. That was the first time they attacked downfield, and he came up a little bit short.
Hardest to the redshirt freshman is the tailback. Ainge, good play fake again. Really air nails this one. Yeah, it was intended for Brett Smith, who was wide open.
That looked a real misfire. By looking at Eric's body language, it looks like it's more on him than receiver. There was a corner blitz from the bottom, but that was no problem. I mean, Smith was wide open coming out of the route, and Eric Ainge. Yeah, that ball just really took off. Now, part of it was he was kind of moving as he threw. He didn't really just step into it and make a solid throw.
Crowd's back into it on 3rd and 10. Blitz coming. Ainge throws incomplete, intended for Meacham. It was behind him.
Well, they've let some opportunities slip by right now, and they're allowing South Carolina to stay in the game. They missed the long one to Meacham on first down. He missed a wide open Brett Smith on second down, and he made a poor throw on that third down play. And that didn't look like the Eric Ainge we saw in the first half.
No. Last week, of course, he had a terrible first half and a great second half. Colquitt to kick to McKinley. This is a better kick. There's a flag down. McKinley muffs it. Tennessee says they've got it. No signal from the official.
And the key will be, what is the penalty?
Pushing, grabbing, biting, spitting, anything in there. And it's Tennessee football. Now we'll check the penalty. Huge break for South Carolina. Robert Ayers called for the infraction.
Well, once again, a mistake by Tennessee or a breakdown has taken away a golden opportunity for Tennessee.
And Philip Fulmer not happy. Colquitt will punt again. And McKinley drops back inside his own 15. 8:08 to go, third quarter. Another pretty kick by Colquitt.
McKinley didn't want to mess with that one, and he should have caught it.
Look at this. Wow. Out of bounds at the one.
See, McKinley was freaked out. He didn't want to touch that ball because he muffed the last one, and that was one he should have fielded on the 10-yard line.
Colquitt, 57 yards, ends up putting it in the coffin corner. Mm.
ESPN's College Football Primetime, brought to you by Ford. Bold moves, they happen every day. And the United States Postal Service. Let your packages know their ride is here. Request a pickup at USPS.com.
The Heisman Trophy won at South Carolina by the great George Rogers. What a college running back he was.
Does he carry that in the back of his SUV there or what? He had it right out there in front of his tailgate.
Got to start from the one, and Boyd is pushed back as he almost reached the four. Boyd's run very well tonight, as has Newton.
Well, you hate to start in this kind of field position if you're South Carolina, but they really dodged one, not having another turnover. They overcame the two turnovers in the first half, but that one on the muff punt that was eliminated by the penalty could have been huge here in the second half.
For Boyd, 65 yards on 15 carries tonight. Out of the eye this time, and Newton to throw from the end zone. Double clutched and threw incomplete. Jared Cook, his tight end, couldn't get it. Let's go to Reese.
All right, Mike, the scoring extravaganza between Texas Tech and Texas has slowed a little bit. Selvin Young up and over and into the end zone. That's the only touchdown of the second half so far. Late in the third, Tech holding on to the three-point lead.
Is that the game in Lubbock?
Yes, it is.
First time we ever went down to the ballgame, and we said, if you want to see a tree, drive 200 miles west.
I've never been there.
It's a nice campus. I liked it. Pressure coming. Newton too high. Had a wide open receiver. Sidney Rice would have had the first down.
Well, John Chavis came after Savelle Newton in his own end zone. Newton a little wobbly getting up. He's under pressure. He knows the pressure's coming, and he just unloaded it. But he had Sidney Rice wide open, and it would have been a first down. First punt for Ryan Succop. Only 18 in the season. Only two teams with fewer punts than South Carolina.
Mike West will be back to receive. There's that soccer-style kick.
He fumbled.
Fumbled, and South Carolina had a shot at it.
Wow.
They got it.
How about that?
Robert Meacham coughed it up.
I love the strategy for Tennessee having two return guys. They were ready for that rugby-style kick, and Meacham actually got him in great field position, but then just couldn't hold on to the football. Tennessee punts. The ball's muffed. They get it, but there's a penalty. South Carolina punts. Tennessee fumbles. South Carolina gets it back.
Wow.
What a turnaround.
Chris Hale reached in and knocked it out of his hand, although it wasn't much of a shot.
Just a hand on it.
A tremendous break for South Carolina. They get a first down at their own 27. And then they snap the fumble, or snap the ball, fumbled the snap from center. I'll get that right eventually.
You know, there's a different center in there right now, William Brown. Chris White, I've seen him run in and out a couple times. And William Brown, number 71, now he's coming out again. But what happened, Tennessee stacked the line. They got into an eight-man front that time, and it forced a bad snap.
Every time you change centers, it's different.
Yep. Now Chris White is back in. They're most experienced offensive linemen.
approaching 6 minutes in the third quarter. Newton on the toss. They'll get it out to the 32-yard line as Mike Davis picks up some yardage on the option. Let's go to Holly.
Savelle Newton took such a hit in the end zone on that last series. He took so long to walk back from the end zone back to the huddle. He barely made it back because of the turnover in time to go back on the field. To say he was walking gingerly puts it mildly, but he's a gamer. He's out there. He's trying to get it done, guys, despite taking that big hit.
And it fell on his hip with two Tennessee players on top of him. That's that never feels very good. About 500 plus pounds falling on you.
Well, Steve was shaking earlier in the ballgame as well. Third down, Tennessee trying to change up its defense, come from different angles. This pass underthrown, incomplete, flag is down. Freddie Brown made the catch. This might be offensive interference.
Yeah, I think you're right. It was severely underthrown, which is not always a bad thing. Now, Sidney Rice is celebrating.
Pass interference, number four, defense.
Oh, my goodness.
I've got to see this one again.
The ball was so underthrown that the receiver had to come back to the football. It's Jonathan Wade. Nothing there. Oh, my gosh.
No.
I don't think they should call anything on that. I don't think that was any call, one way or the other.
Certainly not that.
Wow.
He's still wondering what's going on. Now South Carolina's at the Tennessee 48. Davis is the tailback. Newton with time. Deep down the middle.
Great catch by McKinley.
And a flag at the end of the play.
Now that one was defensive pass interference again. But here's what's impressive about Kenny McKinley. He's not a big receiver like Sidney Rice or Robert Meacham, but watch Kenny McKinley use his body, 5'11", 174, to shield the defender, Antoine Stewart. It's a deep post. Watch him shield the defender and go to the football. Box him out, catch the football. And then you see big receivers do that. You don't see little guys do that. And a beautiful throw by Savelle Newton, attacking on first down.
He fought for that ball and got it. They picked the flag up. Because it was interference, they'll take the play instead. And it's first and 10 just outside the 15. South Carolina driving for a touchdown that would give them the lead. Newton under pressure. Savelle Newton, Noah Whiteside will make the catch, his third grab all year, and it's a touchdown.
And how about Savelle Newton? Holly said it, he's a gamer. Shakes off the pounding he took, and back-to-back plays, outstanding effort by Savelle Newton.
What a difference he has made in this offense. The extra point is good, and South Carolina bidding for an upset here at home. And to continue Steve Spurrier's mastery over Tennessee. Here is tonight's Aflac trivia question. Savelle Newton is one of only four players to gain 600 yards passing, rushing, and receiving in a career. Who are the other three? The answer comes later on. Actually, no, two. Third's going to be tough. You know all three, don't you?
I think so.
No? Johnson and Williams are deep. Marcellus Johnson, a yard in the end zone.
Oh, hello.
Right in the grill, Curtis Rice.
I want to go back to this touchdown because this is vintage Steve Spurrier. Sidney Rice is out. Kenny McKinley's out. This is Mo Brown. This is Mike West. This is Noah Whiteside. Three guys that aren't your starting receivers. These guys are going to go across the field that way. Whiteside's going to slip out this way. It's play action. Tennessee has to be thinking run because their starting receivers aren't in. And then they go misdirection, and Newton sets it up perfectly and throws it to the opposite corner. What a perfect play call in that situation.
Whiteside just weaved his way through everybody in that secondary. Ainge comes out throwing low and behind, incomplete.
This is an important drive for Eric Ainge in Tennessee. Their first touchdown drive, they went 85 yards for the score. Since then, their last four drives, they've totaled 80 yards, and they've only got 4 points. So this is a critical juncture in the game for him to take control again. He did it in the fourth quarter against Alabama last week. Will he be able to do it on the road here in Columbia?
Meacham and Smith are the wideouts on second and 10. Ainge again, complete this time.
First time the tight end has been involved, Chris Brown.
And Brown, with his 18th catch of the year, he is a very talented kid, can play wide receiver.
Even that one, but Eric Ainge got away with that one. He was backing up as he threw. He was kind of reacting to pressure when he didn't have to, but he was able to get the completion to Chris Brown.
Hardesty. Couple of yards, that's it. Let's go to Holly.
Guys, after that last touchdown celebration had kind of calmed down on the South Carolina sideline, Savell Newton sat on the bench and pulled a paper out of his play calling cards on his muff. It was a paper that says, "My commitment as a Christian." He took some quiet time by himself and read what looks like a poem or a little sermon, tried to get himself refocused. Guys, it was his love for the Christian church that caused him to quit football as a child, but he has come back, and boy, is he playing well.
Boy, is he ever. Ainge with time, throws underneath, complete. That's going to be very close to a first down as Meacham came back for the ball.
Well, you just got to be, you know, I enjoyed, we visited with him off the practice field Thursday, and, you know, he was playing receiver. He wanted to be a receiver. He thinks he projects at the next level as receiver. And after the second game, they came to him. He was going to his receiver meeting. They came to him and said, "Hey, you're the quarterback now." He says, "Nuh-uh, not me. I'm not playing quarterback." But he has settled into it. And, boy, he just gets better each game he plays.
Yes, he does. He knows his future is something else, though. Ainge goes to his tight end again, this time out to the 48-yard line. And they have featured the tight end a little bit more tonight than they normally do. But Cottom's been involved three different times coming out from his tight end spot.
Well, part of that is the respect they have for the South Carolina secondary. I mean, they have been holding opponents to under 50% completions. They have 8 interceptions as a secondary. And so the areas where they can exploit the tight end, the running backs, they've done that tonight.
Tennessee responding well after being stunned by South Carolina. Ainge with time. This one's overthrown. There was contact with Swain. No flag.
I think they just got their feet tangled up. I didn't see any real pushing with hands or arms. I think they just got their feet tangled up. I might be wrong, but... Well, there is a little push with the right hand.
That was Captain Munnerlin. Been called for less.
Yeah, you're right. We've seen a couple go South Carolina's way that didn't look like pass interference or any more than that.
Second and 10, a minute 21 to go, third quarter. Is there an upset brewing in Columbia? Blitz coming. They pick it up. Great job by the backs to block on the blitz. And the pass is complete down to the 40. Let's check in with Reese.
All right, Mike, UCLA taking on a resurgent Washington State team. 15-14 in the third. Alex Brink of Wazoo to Brandon Gibson. He's going to slip into the end zone. Washington State with a 23-15 lead in the fourth.
You wore that ugly black and white. You probably don't like those blue uniforms.
It was not black. It was very dark blue.
It must have been very dark. Hardesty.
Ontario pick up four. On the carry for Tennessee, Emmanuel Cook and Jasper Brinkley on the stop, along with Stanley Doty for Carolina.
Philip Fulmer has got to be enjoying this year a lot more than last year when his team struggled so much.
And he said it was miserable last year on many different levels, but a fun team to coach this season.
Second and six. Hardesty trying to get to the outside and does. First down at the 28-yard line. Chris Brown threw him a nice block.
It's a nice run check at the line of scrimmage by Eric Ainge. Big Aaron Sears, number 76, with a big block. Chris Brown with a block. And then down the field, Meacham also with a block. I think that's Meacham who was blocking downfield, and the back actually ran into the back of Meacham's legs.
Can't lose him.
He looks to be okay. He's got to sit out for a play.
8 seconds to go in the third quarter. And as soon as they wind the clock, we'll start ticking down and have only 15 minutes left to go from Columbia, where South Carolina has the lead after scoring 17 straight against number 8 Tennessee. ESPN's College Football Primetime is broadcast in high definition and presented by Pioneer Plasma Displays. 15 minutes to go from Columbia. Tennessee jumped on top 14-0. The Gamecocks will spend the rest of the night catching up and going ahead. But Tennessee is driving. First and 10 for Ainge. And around.
Wow, is that a hold? They called it too.
Yes, they did. Smith was brought down and looked like the All-American candidate Aaron Sears will be flagged for the hold.
Rodney Polk, number 45, played this play beautifully, and he was the guy that forced the holding call. And another costly penalty, really a momentum killer, as this Tennessee drive, very impressive.
Holding, number 76, offense, 10-yard penalty, repeat first down.
It is Sears.
Take a look right here. Now watch how well this is played by Rodney Polk. He stays at home on the reverse. He keeps outside position, and he forces the hold by Aaron Sears. See that left hand grab the jersey, and then that's a takedown. That's just good fundamental defense by Polk against a very good offensive tackle.
They back him all the way up to the 38-yard line. Hardesty is the tailback. Ainge just overthrown, intended for Meacham. I thought he was going to get that one.
They had what they wanted. They had single coverage, Meacham working on Munerlin, and he beat him off the line of scrimmage, used his strength to get separation, and the ball just a slight overthrow to the inside.
Second and 20. Right now, the penalty has put them out of field goal range. Ainge over the middle, Smith. Not much, got down to the 33-yard line, but Stoney Woodson with another big play.
Part of the problem on that play is one of the things that David Cutcliffe talks about a lot with Eric Ainge is ball placement or ball location, where you throw it. A route like that, you want to throw it where he can catch it and not break stride and keep running. Because that ball was behind Smith, he wasn't able to get any yardage after he made the catch.
Third and 15. From here, it would be a 50-yard field goal try. Blitz coming.
Nice pickup.
And Ainge throws complete. They've got a first down inside the 15-yard line.
Boy, what a great job by Montario Hardesty on the blitz pickup. Because this blitz was hit on the move. Watch this come full speed and watch Hardesty step right up in there and pick up the blitz. Excellent job to buy Eric Ainge enough time to find the crossing route. That's really good work. And again, Hardesty is the number three back. Coker got hurt last week. Hardesty's playing time picking up. Swain playing injured, makes a big catch. A huge conversion on third down for the Vols.
Pretty good pass protection for a redshirt freshman. First and 10, Tennessee. Ainge.
Wow.
To the sideline, touchdown. Smith. Brett Smith beat Carlos Thomas. But there's a penalty flag down at the 12. In fact, there's one on each side.
Yeah, would suggest offsides against South Carolina.
Offsides, number 55, defense. Penalties declined, touchdown.
Stanley Doty, the nose tackle. And the South Carolina injury as well. It looks like Fred Bennett. He's their best defensive back. Up a little gimpy and nailed right at the end of that play. And that looks like a cramp the way he's holding his foot.
Well, we talked about ball placement and ball location for Eric Ainge. That ball was beautifully placed for Brett Smith outside where his guy could make the catch and then break one tackle and get in the end zone.
Will Hoyt for the point after. And Tennessee responds by regaining a lead, 21-17. Smokey gets a new hat. They're hanging from the rafters at Williams-Brice, and they've seen a good one. Tennessee on top of South Carolina by four after a 79-yard drive by the Volunteers offense. It pays off with a touchdown that gets them the lead.
A change of strategy here in the second half. They tried to run the ball in the first half, not very successful. Much more passing here in the second half.
Munnerlin from the eight. And stuffed as he got to the 17-yard line. The answer to tonight's Aflac trivia question, Savelle Newton, one of only four players to gained 600 yards passing, rushing, and receiving in a career. Who are the other three? Kyle Rote, SMU, great player. Dave Junger, Ohio University, 70-72. And Hines Ward for Georgia, 1995-1998. I thought Antoine Randall L. would be in there. He had a great career at Indiana. I guess didn't play enough wide receiver to get to that mark. South Carolina trying to get something started on the ground with Corey Boyd. Let's go to Reese Davis.
All right, Mike, we've been keeping an eye on the Texas Tech game all night. 31-28, Tech hanging on to the lead. Colt McCoy, Quan Cosby, the Longhorns have the lead. They picked off a pass a few moments ago, got the ball back, 35-31 in the fourth.
Shoot at down in Texas tonight. 12 minutes to go in this one. Got about 3 yards out of the run after they changed the play. Let's take a look at the ESPNU All-State standings review. And the big shocker, USC, goes down at Oregon State.
As you can see, the big difference in the BCS average between number three and number four, that's going to really open things up for the winner of West Virginia-Louisville next week and a bunch of one-loss teams, Tennessee being one of those.
We'll have that West Virginia-Louisville game for you on ESPN on Thursday night. That's going to be huge. Boy, and Rice comes up wanting to flag immediately. He thought he was interfered with by Jonathan Wade.
Well, we've seen a couple calls go against Tennessee that really didn't look like much. I mean, I guess they could have called that, but I don't think they needed to. A little extra juice on this Tennessee defense after that last scoring drive by the Vols. Got good penetration on first down on the run. He got a three and out.
Hefty is back to take the punt. He's averaging a crisp 13-9 in return. South Carolina getting some people out there late, and this is an odd-looking formation, isn't it? Double gunners on both sides. And a low line drive kick taken back at the 30. Hefty, if he can get to the outside, he's got something going. Blockers in front, and Hefty all the way down to the 5.
Hefty on the return.
South Carolina get too cute for its own good?
They might have. I mean, they were running guys on. They changed up the formation. Then the kick was so low that Hefty had a lot of room. Didn't even have to make the first guy miss. He was up the field 10 yards before he even encountered a black shirt. He had a big game last week against Alabama, averaged over 17 yards on 6 punt returns. This one even better. Had a 40-yarder last week. This one, 50, 65 yards.
65 after a punt of 50. And now it's smack on the backs of the South Carolina defense to keep Tennessee out of the end zone. I think the punt over got more than 15 feet off the ground. Foster. Nice lane. Foster into the end zone. Touchdown.
Boy, what a turnaround for the Vols.
Well, that was just power. And look at the reaction among the faithful. You can hear a pin drop in this place now. They may be taking another look at this.
Well, did the ball cross the plane? That's the question. Good, powerful run by Foster. Was his knee down before the ball crossed? I don't think. I think he fell on Woodson before maybe his knee or hip made contact. Hard driving run and way to capitalize by the Vols after the big special teams play. Their kickoff return has not been very good this year, but their punt return really has made drastic improvement as the season has gone on, and Hefty a big reason for that.
After further review, the play stands as called on the field. Touchdown.
So Tennessee has increased its lead to 27-17 pending the extra point.
Jonathan Hefty trying to catch his breath because he's going to have to come right back on the field to play defense.
Will Hoyt knocks it through. 28-17, number 8 Tennessee back in control.
ESPN's College Football Primetime, brought to you by GMC, engineered to the highest standard, professional grade, and ESPN Game Plan, maximum college football. To order, call your pay-per-view provider or log on to ESPN.com. Search Gameplay.
Tennessee has made this a two-score ball game here in the fourth quarter. They're up 28-17 on South Carolina. Tennessee, which had problems with late scoring in the first couple of ball games, has done very well recently. They have 14 points in the second half in this one, or in the fourth quarter, rather. Carlos Thomas on the return. And Thomas down inside the 15-yard line. That's what we're talking about as far as the points. The next four games after a slow start get 68 points in the fourth quarter.
Well, that's the character, and that's, not panicking if things aren't going your way. And they have shown that. They lost the one game to Florida where they had a 10-point lead in the fourth quarter and lost it. And ever since then, they've played much better in that final period.
And they are trying to stay right on the Gators' heels. Newton lost the snap, now trying to sprint out of trouble. And gets to the 15-yard line before he's taken down. Good hustle by Wes Brown, the defensive end.
Savelle Newton has had trouble tonight, about three or four times mishandling a snap. Didn't look like a bad snap, just not able to grab it. But still with the speed and quickness able to avoid a loss and make it a two-yard gain.
Such a good athlete, doesn't seem to make a lot of difference, does it? Four-man rush. Newton hangs in the pocket and throws incomplete, trying to hit the post to Mike West, and West couldn't get there. Let's go to Holly.
Well, guys, as you can imagine, this Tennessee sideline has undergone a dramatic transformation just in the last couple of minutes. The guys on the sideline are saying things like, we've been messing around too long. It's time we put this thing to bed. Got to get our guys out of here, and let's put this thing to rest. One of the things about Tennessee that's been so terrific this year is they've been outstanding in the fourth quarter, not only outscoring opponents heavily, but their defense have come alive, guys.
All right, Holly, they certainly have tonight. Big play here for South Carolina, down two scores, and time becoming a factor. Newton takes off. 25, still on his feet to the 28-yard line. He's got a first down. Guy's pretty special.
Yes, he is. And I like the call by John Chavis because it was a three-man rush, drop eight, third and long, make him stay in the pocket and execute, but he's still able, with eight defenders dropped, to run for the first down just by making some people miss, breaking a few tackles.
11 carries, 62 yards for Newton. Out of the shotgun again. Been taking a long time on the snap. Tennessee only brings four after showing a blitz and another incompletion. That was intended for Whiteside, who caught the touchdown pass earlier. Demetrius Morley on the coverage.
Well, yet another SEC game for South Carolina where Sidney Rice is not a big factor in their offense. And that's kind of been the story this year. He had eight catches, 112 yards, two touchdowns last year in the win up in Knoxville. Only two catches tonight.
He was a freshman All-American, and by just comparing the numbers, he is going through a sophomore slump. Newton again, that ball is tipped up and near an incomplete. Rice wants a flag,
the ball
and
was
they
tipped.
Will get it.
They'll wave the flag off, I think, because the ball was tipped.
Looked like Ryan Carl got a hand on it.
There's no foul for defensive pass interference. The pass was tipped. Third down.
Well, to bring up another third down and long for Savelle Newton. Ryan Carl, we've seen him get his hands on the ball a couple times tonight. He got the tip, I believe, that was intercepted in the end zone by Wade earlier in the ball game. He's an active guy. You know, he's not maybe the most athletic defensive linebacker that Tennessee has had, but he's very smart, knows where he's going, plays hard. He's been very productive in this defense.
Mentally, that's the toughest spot to play in that defense among the linebackers. Rice again up, beefing about the call, wanted a flag, and really going after the official. He's got to be careful there.
Yeah, he's not going to get any calls doing that. I mean, I understand he's frustrated because he's only had two catches, but that's not going to help him.
And now the crowd reacting to what they see on the Jumbotron. Is back for another punt return. And now they're starting to throw things on the field. You really don't want to see that.
No, no.
What the people who have been overserved and are doing that don't realize, they could hurt their own players, or they could hurt a Tennessee player, and their anger isn't worth it. Just not right.
Well, the third down play, Jonathan Wade working on Rice.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, they could have called that. And we've seen a couple that they've called that they didn't need to call. That one they definitely could have called. And it looked like Jonathan Wade was waiting for the flag.
Yeah, it did.
Turned around and didn't see one. And
well, it was either holding or interference, yeah. One or the other. Just about everybody on this crew has been working through colds tonight. We apologize for our froggy sounding voices, and some of the folks you saw are getting an early escort to the parking lot. Beautiful kick. Hefty driven all the way back to his own 25. Just keeps working and actually got a 3-yard return out of it after a punt of 52. Now there's a marker down. Crowd's really upset about the whole situation.
Illegal formation on the kicking team. Only 6 men on the line of scrimmage. Penalty will be added to the end of the run. First down.
We've seen that called twice tonight. Could a one-loss SEC team make the BCS title game? We'll talk about that when we come back. How does Smokey look in HD? Pretty good, huh? 28-17, Tennessee on top. 8:36 to go in this ball game. And the Volunteers will now start working on this clock. Foster back into the tailback, and now Ainge to Meacham. 10-5.
Is that how you work on the clock?
Didn't take much off of it, did they? Maybe I spoke too soon. 62 yards.
Well, I think it might be a little bit of Tennessee working on some style points, too, as a one-loss team. Beautiful throw by Meacham. They missed on this a couple times earlier. Some deep balls from Ainge to Meacham. This time, right on it. Meacham able to run right under it, not breaking stride against a tiring Carlos Thomas.
And that really makes Meacham's numbers for the night look good. 5 catches, 106. Foster. nowhere to go.
Just been impressed with Meacham this year. I mean, he's led the team in receiving the last 2 years prior to this, but this year he has more than doubled his yardage from last year, and he has lived up to his what everybody expected him to be when he came here out of Tulsa, Oklahoma. He lost some weight. He got himself in great condition. He really bought into David Cutcliffe's style of practicing with game speed, game tempo. Trooper Taylor, the new wide receiver coach, has been a great addition to his training and his preparation.
And he is every bit a legitimate candidate for the Blitnikoff Award. Lucas Taylor getting his hands on the ball for the first time, but they whistle the play dead.
You know, there are only six receivers in college football this year that are averaging.
Before the snap, first charge timeout, Tennessee.
Only six receivers that are averaging over 100 yards per game receiving. And Robert Meacham is one of those six.
Let's go to Reese. He has a SportsCenter 30 at 30 update.
All right, Mike, sports has lost one of its legendary champions. Arnold Red Auerbach, the great Celtic coach, is dead at the age of 89. Auerbach won a record 9 NBA titles, a record that he shares with Phil Jackson. 16 of his 20 years as a coach spent with the Celtics, had only one losing season and won nearly two-thirds of his games during his great career as the head coach of the Celtics. Much more on Red Auerbach's life and legacy on SportsCenter after the game, ESPN News on all the time.
All right, Reese, you never had to ask where you stood with Red Auerbach. He was happy to tell you. He had been in ill health for quite a while. Last time I saw him last basketball season in the Washington, D.C. area, he was struggling with his health, but what a great guy. What a wonderful career he had. You know, he had no assistant coaches, I think, until maybe the last year that he was the head coach of the Boston Celtics. Didn't need any. Uncle, they don't discuss sports, they talk about life, is the general manager of the Celtics. Second and goal. Ainge, quarterback draw. How about this? Flag is down, so is Ainge. You'll lose a couple.
South Carolina offsides, trying to blitz. Kind of a desperate situation now for South Carolina. Got to cross into that neutral zone.
I'm not sure that was the play they were trying to run.
I don't know. It looked like a designed quarterback draw.
Offsides, number 52, defense. Half the distance to the goal. Repeat second down.
Jasper Brinkley, the middle linebacker. And Ainge, a little gimpy.
Yeah.
Good numbers, 20 of 28, two touchdowns, almost 250 yards passing.
Last week, he struggled in the first half. Three interceptions against Alabama, but played very well in the second half. 17 of 25, led him on a touchdown drive at the end, and he has really been solid here in the second half tonight.
Second and goal. Foster, nowhere to go, taking it down near the 9-yard line. Casper Brinkley from the defensive end spot in the backfield in a heartbeat.
Casper Brinkley had four tackles behind the line of scrimmage last week against Vanderbilt. That's his second tonight.
Now, I think smart defensive players take advantage of a play like that. They know Ainge is not going to keep the ball in his hands, not the way he's limping. So it's got to be a run. Now Ainge will go to the shotgun on third and goal. South Carolina's defense can hold. It would still be a two-touchdown score game. Tight end, Brown, down to the 4-yard line. Or caught him, rather. Hampton makes the tackle, and it will be fourth and goal. And here comes Tennessee's field goal team. So South Carolina would still have a chance down by 14 points if this field goal is good.
Time not on their side, though, as we're going to approach 5 minutes here. Tennessee smartly allowing that clock to get down as much as it can.
Not much more than an extra point, 21-yard field goal attempt. And it's 31-17. Tennessee extends its lead to 14. Just over 5 minutes to go from Columbia. The Rutgers Scarlet Knights remain undefeated and continue to be the surprise of the college football year. Sunday night, they host Connecticut. College football primetime, part of Showdown Sunday, presented by Altel Wireless on ESPN at 8 Eastern. College football lives here.
That's a big game. Of course, the marquee game in the Big East is a few days later, Thursday night. West Virginia undefeated at undefeated Louisville at Papa John Stadium. That'll be a hugely significant game.
Line drive kick.
Oh, their kickoff return is bad.
Oh. Carlos Thomas ended up falling on it at the 4-yard line. How about that, Reese?
Not good special teams play. Here is Florida State and Maryland. Florida State trying to tie it with a field goal. Do I really even have to show you what happens? I mean, that's why you're Florida State. The field goal's not going. Gary Suspacia got it blocked. Look at Maryland in contention in their division in the ACC.
Oh, my.
Jeez.
My, oh, my. Fear the turtle.
They're going to be a little restless in Tallahassee, aren't they?
A little more, you mean.
Yeah, a little more. Newton just had to get rid of it, gets it out to Corey Boyd. He goes across the 10, and there's a flag down. Looked like it was a hold or a personal foul. Here's Ainge. Here's how he injured that ankle. Yeah, landed awkwardly on him when he spun.
Yeah, right ankle. That could have been a whole lot worse.
Sure could have.
Grabbing the quarterback's helmet. 15-yard penalty from the end of the run. First down.
Ainge walking a little bit better on the sideline right now.
One thing that David Cutcliffe and Philip Fulmer have to be thinking of for Eric Ainge. I mean, Tennessee has a big ball game next week at home against LSU, a very physical defensive football team. May not see any more of Eric Ainge tonight. I don't know.
South Carolina needs a touchdown. They need it in a hurry. Newton faked the slide, got out to the 40-yard line, could have a first down. He's a nifty little player.
Yes, he is. Great competitor. And there's no way South Carolina would have been in the position that they've been in coming into this game without him, because he makes a bunch of plays with his athleticism. His guts, toughness, and his arm.
Newton throws this one underneath to McKinley. McKinley trying to work this way, looking for an extra block, and got it out of the 43-yard line. Freddie Brown, number 82, threw him a good block in that sequence.
Freddie Brown just sizes him up, keeps his head in the front. McKinley trying to make something happen, get as much yardage as he can, and then gets out of bounds to stop the clock.
If you're a blocker, you start drooling about 5 seconds before that hit. Just knowing you can unload on somebody. Trying to buy time. Now he takes off and gets out of bounds at 32.
Another first down.
It's got to be so frustrating for a defensive line.
Yeah. Well, in Tennessee right now, I mean, they know that South Carolina needs two scores. So they're going to play a lot of zone, try to keep everything in front, not give up any easy ones.
And while they're doing that, Newton is ripping off 10 yards a shot. Mm-hmm. 13 carries, 84 yards for the senior from Wallace, South Carolina. Newton again throws incomplete, threw that into traffic, intended for Mo Brown. Covered very well by Morley. And Mitchell was putting the pressure on him.
I'll guarantee you one thing, Savelle Newton, I bet he sleeps well on Saturday night because he gets his money's worth out here. Running around, throwing his body around.
Clock down to 3 minutes and 49 seconds. Screen, Boyd. Runs into his own man, stays on his feet. Boyd inside the five, down to the three.
Nice job of running by Boyd. He's broken tackles a lot tonight. This looked like he was going to be stopped for about a 5-yard gain, and instead Boyd takes it inside the five. Ryan Carl had a good shot at him and just missed him. And Boyd took this ball all the way inside the 5-yard line.
Mark it at the two, first and goal. Newton for the corner, tipped and incomplete. Good job by Antoine Stewart. He was covering Sidney Rice. Wasn't much air under that throw.
We want to throw that up in the air for Sidney. He's 6'4", give him a chance to jump, which he did.
I mean, didn't he want, that wasn't a fade, but didn't he watch Game Day when you demonstrated how to throw that thing?
That's a little different route there, but he gave him a chance. You like that, huh?
Oh, absolutely.
I just want to make sure I didn't run Desmond off the side of that field.
Movement up front, looks like that's going to go against Thomas Coleman, the guard who moved early.
Before the snap, false start, number 69, offense, 5-yard penalty, still second down.
They'll give it to Seth Edwards instead, but it will be second and goal. Well, the task is pretty clear. You have to score here.
Right.
And then either go for an onside kick or kick it deep and hope the defense can make a stand with two timeouts and get the ball back.
Double pass.
Rice in trouble, dives, got down inside.
Should have dove out of bounds. Should have dove out of bounds, or he tried to get to the end zone. But by not getting out of bounds, they either have to use a timeout or they're going to lose a lot of time getting up to this next play. This was supposed to be a double pass. It was thrown behind the line, but Rice did the smart thing in not throwing it. But he could have helped his team by diving out of bounds at the end of the play.
Third and goal, burning precious seconds here. And a flag goes down. Needs to be more of a sense of urgency in that situation.
I don't know if the numbers really are that, but it feels like we've had a lot of penalties in this game.
It does, doesn't it?
I mean, I don't know if we have actually had a lot, but.
There's no foul on the play. Still second down. Gretchen, third down.
Well, what about the time that went off the clock? I mean, that.
Well, I don't think they'll restart it until this, now they're going to run it.
Boy.
And South Carolina can't. Newton was not ready for that snap. And they're very lucky it hit him right in the gut. He hung on and scored.
I mean, they've had some problems with the snap tonight.
I mean, it could have hit him anywhere. It could have gone right by him because he was not ready for it.
Yeah.
That's what he had to catch.
Hello. Now the extra point will make it a 7-point lead. Now here's today's Good Hands flashback presented by Allstate. Last season, Steve Spurrier came back to Knoxville for the first time as South Carolina's head coach. Sidney Rice had 8 catches for 112 yards and 2 touchdown passes. Josh Brown had the field goal with 2:45 left, a 49-yarder. And then South Carolina wins at 16-15 to break a 15-game losing streak to Tennessee. And Steve Spurrier said Josh Brown was halfway out on the field before he'd made his decision about kicking the field goal. Yeah. And Brown says, field goal, right, coach? And he said, if you want to kick it, go do it.
Yeah, said if he'd have been hiding behind some guys, he'd have maybe changed his mind and called a play. But that was a huge win for South Carolina.
All right, what do you do here? 2 timeouts left. Do you kick it deep and try to hold them?
I think you might have to go with an onside kick here. I mean, I know you got the 2 timeouts. If they would have been able to stop the clock right there and maybe stayed above 3 minutes before they score, then I think maybe you take the chance and kick it. At this point, I think you almost have to go for an onside kick.
And Tennessee thinking the same way. They're lined up. They have 10 players now within that 10-yard limit. The clock here will start as soon as the ball is kicked, not when it's touched by the receiving team. Picked up by Smith. So they had the good hands team in there. Let's go to Reese.
All right, Mike, I want to show you how things finished down in Lubbock in the shootout between Texas and Texas Tech. Late in the fourth quarter, 3rd down play, Colt McCoy getting pressure, and look at the savvy redshirt freshman. Gets across that yellow line for the first down, then slide, burn up the rest of the clock. Texas on the road, hangs on by 4.
All right, Reese, thanks very much. 35-31. All right, South Carolina still with the 2 timeouts.
Range is out.
They're going to give it to Hardesty. And obviously still gimpy on that ankle, and Jonathan Crompton is in at quarterback. He's a freshman. And timeout South Carolina. They stop it at the 2-minute mark. Crompton, a North Carolina product.
Eric's ankle must really be bothering him because, I mean, at this point, you know, you've got to secure the snap because you just can't afford for something goofy to happen. You know, you've got the game, and you want to make South Carolina burn their timeout, but that means securing the snap, making a good solid handoff, and then Stowe, instead of Eric Ainge right now, your starter, you've got freshman Jonathan Crompton in to do that. So Ainge's ankle, obviously, not great right now.
Crompton has only thrown the ball 4 times this year. They've all been complete. He's run it 3 times for 7 yards. So he has had very little action.
The biggest thing that Crompton has to do if he's coming back in is the first thing, he must make sure that he keeps his hands in there with Josh McNeil and gets a good clean snap. Now, if I'm South Carolina, I take my strongest defensive lineman and I put him right over the center and I try to disrupt that timing and the snap of the quarterback to see if we can knock the ball loose, because the only chance
South Carolina has right now is if they can get a turnover.
They've got Doty on the nose right now. Crompton changing the play, and the coaching staff on the sideline didn't like the way that
looked. Why would he be changing the play?
That's what they want to ask him. They just took a timeout.
Run it.
As soon as he turned around to change the play, the coaching staff, almost as a group, sprinted toward midfield.
Eric Ainge wants in the game. He's got his chin straps buckled. And he doesn't look like a guy that doesn't want to be in right now. And I understand that this is probably the game plan. You know, if they give us this look, let's run this. But in this situation of the field, you know, just run the play. Make South Carolina burn up their timeouts. I think Ainge might be coming back in now. I don't know.
He might be. Doesn't look like whatever argument it was that Crompton's winning it. Let's go to Holly.
Guys, Eric Ainge is trying to talk his way back in this game, and he may have just been successful with Phil Fulmer. He's got his headgear buckled. Nope, they're going to put Crompton back out there, guys. Eric is trying to get back in this game. He's worried about the mistakes that the freshman quarterback's making, but he is in quite a bit of pain when he drops back on that ankle. He's wincing. He's got a problem that he's not going to get back in right now, guys.
Well, I can't see him throwing the ball in this situation. Can you?
No.
Hardesty hit at the line, still drives his way forward to the 45. Now the clock will run. Last timeout called by South Carolina. So after the third down play, there's no way to stop it for them anymore.
Well, one of the big discussion points now with USC losing today will be, will the winner of the West Virginia-Louisville game, if that team stays undefeated, be able to hold off a one-loss team from a conference like the SEC? Of course, Texas, a one-loss team, but several teams from this conference, the SEC, Tennessee down there at 11, Auburn, Florida. Will a one-loss team be able to gain ground or ultimately pass a West Virginia or Louisville? Again, look at the difference. And the points is not very much separating those one-loss teams.
Well, I think West Virginia's points would go up dramatically if they beat Louisville. The same for Louisville. But West Virginia, obviously, starting with the advantage of being number four as opposed to being number seven. I think it's more problematic with Louisville jumping from seventh to third than it would be West Virginia.
You got Auburn and Florida right behind them. Potentially could win out and play each other again in the SEC championship game in Atlanta.
This one's not over yet. Third and 10. Crompton at quarterback. Hardesty. Dropped it to 41. And now they will squeeze every second they can out of this clock. Be a 25-second clock. As soon as the ball's marked ready for play, it will start to run. And now the officials are going to stop it for an injury.
The other thing that South Carolina has to be aware of with no timeouts left is that when the ball changes possession, the clock will start again on the ready. Right now, it'll be a minute 12 at the least that South Carolina will get the ball.
Bennett's having cramp problems again.
They'll start this clock when they clear the field. And then Tennessee would be wise to let that 25-second clock go all the way down before they punt the football.
If they can make sure they get all 25 seconds out of it and take the penalty and back it up 5 yards, that's not going to hurt the punting game. Yeah. Then if you're South Carolina, you have to decide if you're going to come after the kicker or you're going to drop back for the return. It's 31-24 with a minute 13 to go. Both of these teams are in the SEC East, as is Florida. The Gators beat Georgia in Jacksonville today. They have one loss. Tennessee has one loss, but that was to Florida, so they lose on the tiebreaker. South Carolina has two losses, but if they would win this game and next week against Arkansas, they would be the team controlling its own destiny. SportsCenter will follow our broadcast when we're done here. Of course, we're only one play away from overtime. Have to be a heck of a play, wouldn't it? Colquitt will come on to kick. Let's see if South Carolina tries to come after them. McKinley is back at his 10. Colquitt gets it out of there and hangs it beautifully high. Fair catch made at the 9. So Savelle Newton, 91 yards away from a tie ball game. And 106 to do it with no timeouts.
And again, they've got to get out and get lined up, because as soon as this ball is marked ready for play, the clock will start. The new timing rules in college football, and they have no timeouts. So they have to maximize all of their time. And already they've lost a little because they had a late player joining the formation, Noah Whiteside.
Steve Spurrier has always had magic against Tennessee. He'll need all of it he can get right now. Rice stays in bounds. They've got to hustle.
Well, that's a costly play there. If the first down at least stops the clock long enough to move the chains.
Well, the official standing right on top of that ball. He can't even get to it.
Yeah, Savelle Newton's mad that it took so long to be able to get the snap to spike it. Tennessee was hanging out around the football, and they weren't able to
he's
get
got a
him
good
away.
Argument.
Yes, he does.
Because the official, the only time he's really going to stop it there, stand over it, is when the chains are moved. And the chains did not have to move on that. So Tennessee got a little break from the clock. That one's batted down and caught by an offensive lineman. And this will bring up a fourth down. The clock is going to run. They're going to try to unpile him. Newton is trying to call a play here and line everybody up. All up to Newton. Throws a jump ball downfield and it's intercepted. And that will do it. Demetrius Morley took a desperation pass from Newton and made the catch. And South Carolina certainly did not manage the last minute of time that they had on that clock very well. Tennessee, a winner, 31-24. SportsCenter coming up next. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For Todd Blackledge, Holly Rowe, and our entire ESPN crew, this is Mike Patrick. Good night from Columbia.